My name is Dirk Pfeiffer. I am a veterinarian and professor of veterinary epidemiology. I work at the veterinary college. This is the second video in a series on diagnostic test interpretation. And with this particular video, I would like to introduce the concept of predictive values. As I had emphasized in the video on sensitivity and specificity, the uses of diagnosis range from quite a range. I mean, there are quite a number of objectives, one of them being just whether I would just want to determine whether there is a health problem or not. I may want to be able to come up with a prognostic diagnosis. I may have to make decisions about treatment, or I may have to evaluate the fitness or productivity of an animal. Now, it is quite useful to be aware or think of the different factors which influence the process or are involved in the process of diagnostic reasoning. So if we start with a case, and where the case could be any animal that a veterinarian has to examine, could be an animal within a herd, so in this case on the image there, a calf, or it could be a dog. The first step is the diagnostic examination, and there are a whole number of factors that influence the diagnostic or are part of the diagnostic examination process. And once that is completed, the veterinarian has to make a diagnosis, and the tricky bit is whether that diagnosis actually fits the true disease status of the animal. So there's some uncertainty associated with that relationship between the diagnosis and the true disease status of the animal, which is obviously quite a difficult situation for the diagnostician, but also for the owner of the animal. Now, that uncertainty in relation to whether the diagnosis is a true reflection of the disease status is affected by a number of factors. And these include, of course, the factual knowledge that the veterinarian has about the diagnostic process. There's also an element of intuition, which doesn't necessarily have to be a bad thing. What is very important is the experience that a veterinarian has, and obviously if somebody who has just graduated will have less of that. In fact, they might actually have more better or more up-to-date factual knowledge than an older veterinarian, whereas the veterinarian that has been working for longer will have more experience. Then there's the prevalence of the of the disease, or that one may be considering, and the role of the prevalence is of critical importance if I want to look at the role of predictive values, which is what we will be covering during this video. Now, what else is there? Obviously, the prevalence will also influence intuition, so as well as experience. So things, diseases that I have seen more often, I will have more experience with, whereas diseases which are very rare may not come to mind. They may not be in the list of differential diagnoses that one thinks of. The factual knowledge then, therefore, also influences the diagnosis that is being made by the veterinarian, as does the intuition, as does the experience. And finally, we've got the role of Bayesian logic, or logic, i.e. the ability to utilize the information contained in prevalence and the diagnostic test characteristics that will help us to reduce or be more conscious of the uncertainty that's associated with this relationship between the diagnosis that has been made and the true disease status of the animal. So, the diagnostic test is there to basically modify probabilities, even if the diagnostician, the veterinarian, doesn't really think about in those probabilities, but actually they may do so intuitively. So it is actually that the test as such is a more or less objective method, in addition to the other factors that we've just talked about on a previous slide. The outcome is, and this is the tricky bit, of course, is the diagnosis, i.e., like a dichotomous parameter in the sense that it has two values. The animal is diagnosed as being diseased or not diseased. But in fact, what often happens is that the diagnostic tests measure some continuous scale parameters, such as serum antibody levels or somatic cell counts. And then another decision has to be made in relation to from which value onwards the test is considered to be positive. But that will be a topic for a later video. Okay, so now if I want to look at the test performance in the context of interpretation of the individual animal, I need to be aware of the role of predictive values. And what they are is they are an estimate of the probability that the test result that we have obtained, okay, so we've already done the test, we've got the test result, and the question is now, what's the probability that the animal truly has the disease or truly does not have the disease? So one is the predictive value of the for a positive test result, and the other one is the predictive value for a negative test result. What information do I need to be able to estimate those values? They are the performance characteristics of the test, which we've covered in in my other video, so the sensitivity and specificity, and some idea of the prevalence of the condition in the population. I mean, that can also be, I mentioned prior probability here, because if I have, if the animal shows particular clinical signs, I can actually adjust the prevalence of the animal, of the general population. And so if there are signs which are indicative of the disease, that would mean I basically assume a higher chance that the animal has the disease without having done the diagnostic test yet. Okay, so that's quite an important concept to keep in mind when interpreting the test result. So it's not just the prevalence of the condition in the general population. I need to take advantage of other information that I collect during the diagnostic examination to revise the probability, the prior probability of the animal having the disease before I interpret the diagnostic test result. The predictive values are interpreted at the individual animal level, and they cannot be used to compare tests. I use sensitivity and specificity to compare tests. Okay, so everything is relative, indeed. And so what I would like to do now is I'll use an example. And it's a herd, which a cattle herd, which has cows, which are, some of them are infected with tuberculosis or mycobacterium bovis, and some are not infected. And in fact, we have, we make the assumption that we have more extensive knowledge in that 85% are not infected and 15% are infected. Keep in mind that you often actually don't, usually don't have that knowledge. Now, one of those cows is from the herd is to be sold, and the question, and the animal has been tested, and the test was negative. We know that the tuberculin test has about 80% sensitivity, and the specificity is quite high, so about 95%. So the question is now, what are the chances that this particular cow really is uninfected? Now, let's go through the process here. So the first step I would like to look at is the role of prevalence. So here's our herd of cows. In fact, we've got exactly 100. And that is what it would look like according to the true prevalence of 15%. So we've got 15 cows in red, which are truly diseased. So the question is now, given that we're interested in knowing whether a cow that was negative to the test truly doesn't have the disease, how do we how can we work out that probability? Okay, so there we go. Number one is, let's look at the test, the role of test sensitivity. So this obviously only applies to the cows which truly have the disease. So given that the test has a sensitivity of 80%, that means of the 15 cows which are truly infected, it will correctly identify 12. Okay, so that's, there we are. So there are three false negatives, which I've indicated in yellow. Then the role of the test specificity, which only applies to the cows that truly do not have the disease, and the test had a 95% specificity. So that means of the 85 cows which truly don't have the disease, it will correctly identify as not diseased 81. But that also means it will there will be four false positives. So now, how do we get to the predictive value of the negative test result then? So here's our information. So the first thing is we have 84 animals which will test negative, or 81 of the 84 are truly non-infected. So that means the negative predictive value is 85 divided by 84, so 96%. So the cow that we are considering here, which tested negative, has a 96% chance of not being infected. So this is quite important information, very useful information then for whoever is going to buy this cow and introduce it into their herd. Now, I could also, of course, look at this story from the other side and assess the positive predictive value. And what we have in this particular case is when you look at the orange and the red cows, they are positive. Okay, some of them are false positives, and the others are truly infected. So, in fact, 12 are truly infected of the 16, which were test positive, and that gives us a positive predictive value of 75%. So, a cow, a random cow that tested positive in this particular herd has a 75% chance of truly being. So with this particular slide, I would like to look into the importance of prevalence on predictive value. We are assuming that we have a diagnostic test which has 95% sensitivity and 90% specificity. The true prevalence is 3%, so a very low prevalence situation. And when an animal tests positive, as we come up with a positive predictive value of about 23%. So, and that is because, so that sounds quite bad really, and it is because we have, due to the 90% specificity, okay, which applies to the animals that are not infected, but it generates always it generates 10% false positives amongst them, which are the orange cows on my slide. So I actually end up with a lot more orange cows than with red cows. So whenever an animal tests positive in this low prevalence situation, and with these particular test characteristics, I have to be very, very careful in the way how I interpret this test result. So it's got a very high chance of being a false positive. On the other hand, though, with the negatives, and in this case, the animals which test negative are the green cows and the yellow cow, there's a very high chance that the animals really do not have the disease. Okay? So the next scenario is a higher prevalence situation. So this time, 30% true prevalence, and the story changes a lot. So when I look at the positive predictive value, I need to consider the red cows and the orange cows. And now my positive predictive value is much better, okay? Because I have more disease in the herd. And with the 95% sensitivity, I'm able to detect a lot of the disease. And the 10% false positives amongst the non-diseased animals is not quite as significant. The negative predictive value is also pretty good, which is based on the green and the yellow cows. The other factor to keep in mind is the role of the herd, because quite often when I, particularly in the livestock context, when I look at controlling diseases, I take advantage of the concept of the herd infection status, which means that I may take particular measures for the herd if I find at least one test positive animal. And this is the case, for example, with bovine tuberculosis. So if one animal is found to be positive to the tuberculin test, then the herd will not be allowed to move animals, to sell animals, until the herd tests negative again. Now, that also means and that I can actually get away with a test that has a relatively low sensitivity. I mean, when I say relatively, I don't think I would want to use a test that's only 30% sensitive, but a test such as the tuberculin test, which is about 80% sensitive, is actually, one might say, that's not a very high sensitivity. But because if there is infection in the herd, usually, because the disease can spread relatively easily, you would expect multiple animals to be infected, and then it should detect at least one of them. Obviously, that does not work for a disease that has a low prevalence within the herd. The other issue with the herd interpretation of diagnostic tests is actually a bit of a problem, and that is that most tests do not have 100% specificity. And that means even in a herd that has no infection at all, they will produce some false positives. So this is a real problem in disease control campaigns, particularly towards the end of them, when there are few herds with infection, few infected animals, and most of what tests positive ends up being false positives. And if these animals have to be culled, farmers are rather unhappy about those decisions. To conclude, as the same as with the previous video where I talked about sensitivity and specificity, diagnoses are associated with uncertainty as a result of many different factors which I've presented at the beginning of this video, and what we should do is we should take advantage of those relationships. A key factor for interpretation of diagnostic test results is knowledge of the prevalence. And one important lesson to keep in mind here is that in situations where disease prevalence is very low, one has to be very careful with the interpretation of any positive test results. But all in all, I mean, it is essential to use the diagnostic test as part of the whole diagnostic reasoning process, which actually ends up being a process of modifying probabilities. Even if that isn't done in a quantitative sense, it is done in an intuitive way quite often. And that allows the diagnostician to be more cognizant, to be more aware of the uncertainty that's associated with the test result and the relationship between the diagnosis and the true disease status of the animal. And that can then be more effectively communicated to the owner of the animal. With this, I would like to finish this short video. And if anybody is interested in further information about the concepts that I've discussed, there are a number of short courses and also more extensive, masters and diploma courses in distance learning and face-to-face mode at the RBC, and I've presented the web references to those courses on this slide. Thank you very much.